remember your own final MBBS practical exam? Tension was high. Cigarettes, coffee, odd hours, and desperate measures? Wasn't there a mad scramble for the list? The all-important list of admitted and specially called patients? Why? Were you in search of reassurance or the directions for a last-minute cram? Or did you want to be sure that in the Russian roulette of case allotment, you didn't land up with a horrible case? On the day of the examination, it starts early, like lambs to the slaughter. Herd it together, twanging like taut bowstrings. Then finally, the moment of reckoning. You get your long case. 45 minutes later, you get to your examiners.
Finish your long cases.
20 minutes later, you go to the short cases.
You know, yaar, I had a very cool case.
Yeah? I've had it, yaar. They got this stupid fellow from a village and he just wouldn't talk.
I don't know. The endotracheal tube wasn't there and he showed me some fancy thing I'd never seen before.
And the specimens brought by the stupid examiner were very tough. All my efforts go wasted, yaar. This is useless.
Talk about being unfair. Anil gets Ryle's tube and I get...
The element of luck and the whims of the examiners leaves a familiar feeling of the exam being unfair. In the overall assessment of medical competence, several areas of activity need to be evaluated to arrive at a plausible and objective assessment. These include all aspects of medical data gathering, interpretation, and required action. The current examination has many shortcomings. It is subjective, actual skills are not examined adequately, and there is never enough time. So, is all lost? No. Let us examine one method which tries to eliminate some of these shortcomings. Welcome to the Objective Structured Clinical Examination, or OSCE in brief. What is the OSCE? Is it another fancy term for more archaic material? No, it is different. The overall clinical competence to be tested is broken down into compartments. Each compartment is tested in a separate area called a station. A typical OSCE session uses 20 stations and 20 candidates start simultaneously, and they move from one to the next. Some stations assess skills like examination technique and communication, which can only be graded by observation. Here, examiners are essential and are used. At others, for instance, looking at a chest X-ray and answering a structured questionnaire, an examiner is superfluous. These responses are graded later according to a key prepared in advance. A student spends about 4.5 minutes at each station. Another half minute is given for moving from one station to the next. And at the end of 100 minutes, 20 candidates have been examined at 20 stations. The preparation of the OSCE starts a few days in advance. The skills to be tested at each station are identified. For example, a typical OSCE in the subject of medicine has 4 stations on history taking, 8 on physical examination, 2 each on x-rays and on ECGs, 1 each on an instrument and clinical spots, and 2 on the interpretation of laboratory data. In this example, examiners are required in only 6 of the 20 stations. The examiners sit together and discuss to reach a consensus on the correct answer and the weightage of marks for each segment. These students are about to undergo an OSCE. They have had exposure to this system before, and they have been given written instructions.
All candidates will go through all these 20 stations.
Some important instructions are being repeated.
Station has been fixed, at the end of which a bell will ring. Students will move from station 1 to 2, 2 to 3, and so on.
Now let us see what happens at station 1. The student has been asked to elicit the history of the patient's chief complaints. She proceeds to talk to the patient. While the examiner observes what she is doing. Note that the student and the examiner do not interact. The examiner only observes what she is doing and grades her according to an agreed upon pattern. The examiner has a checklist based on an agreed sequence of objective criteria. Did she introduce herself? Were the questions asked clearly? And so on. At the end of a stipulated period of time, the candidate leaves for the next station, while the examiner scores her performance. Station 2. What? Just a table and chair and no examiner? While the previous station was meant to assess the technique of history taking, this one tests the content of the data obtained and her ability to interpret it, and also to answer questions raised in the prepared answer sheet. Questions are framed in such a way that the student needs only to tick at the appropriate place, and this makes the marking very objective. Note that the questions test both factual and analytical functions. While those based on facts have negative marking to prevent bluffing, the analytical ones do not, as multiple inferences can be drawn from the data available. This questionnaire is checked later from a key. No examiner is required. The patient in station 1 need not be a real patient, but can be a carefully rehearsed member of the staff, coached to give responses to pertinent questions. Used repeatedly, he provides uniformity, something which is lacking in the existing system today. The student now goes to station 3. Here, his technique of physical examination of the abdomen will be tested. As he gets busy, the examiner works on his checklist, observing, assessing attitude, technique, and dexterity. Again, there are no words exchanged, no intimidation, no questions, and no getting stuck on a trivial finding. The examiner's checklist consists of crucial components of the technique of abdominal examination, pre-decided by the full team of examiners. At the end of the allotted time, the student leaves. The patient is now ready for the next candidate. The same patient, the same findings, standardized. In the fourth cubicle, like the second, there is no examiner. Only a set of questions based on the physical examination performed in the previous cabin. The candidate is required to commit to paper what he found during the exercise of examining the patient's abdomen. He is also required to interpret what he found. As previously shown, the fact-related questions have negative marking, while the analytical ones do not. We have now examined two major areas of history-taking and physical examination, a point where most current examinations stop. But in the OSCE, there are 8 stations for physical examination and at least 4 for history-taking. All the major systems have 1 case each, and history-taking in 2 important areas is also tested. All this is done in a short time, objectively. The candidate now goes to another important sphere, investigation. She is looking at an X-ray and she answers the questions at the next station. The essence is, if she hasn't been thorough, she cannot go back and recheck while answering the questions. Once again, no examiner is needed. They are being better utilized at another station. At the ECG station, the student gets time to study the ECG in detail. At the next station, he has to commit his findings to paper. Again, there is a factual and analytical component in the questionnaire. At the station on clinical spots, slides are used to test the ability to quickly diagnose diseases for which it is difficult to obtain patients for the examination. At this station, the student not only identifies the instruments, but also answers the questions related to its use. Note that a large number of questions examining in-depth knowledge are asked in this segment, something which is difficult in the limited time available in a conventional viva voce exam. Another useful area is where the student is asked to solve a problem, interpret clinical information with laboratory reports. At the first station, she is given time to go through the problem. At the next, she answers questions related to it. This is one area where most current examinations have serious lacunae. The case viva does not last long enough to get this far. We have gone through a few examples of OSCE stations in the subject of medicine. A similar scheme can be followed in other subjects. The skills to be examined are identified and OSCE planned accordingly. The number of stations can be varied according to the need. The questionnaire for each station needs to be planned carefully. In this example, the first part is framed such that a candidate can answer correctly only if he has followed the steps carefully. Negative marking discourages guessing. The I don't know option carries no penalty. In the analytical part, several options are given to prevent queuing. One or more options may be correct depending upon the situation. The advantages of the OSCE are obvious. The levels of objectivity and reliability are high. A large number of students can be examined in a large number of skills in a short span of time. Extraneous factors are eliminated, and the students have also welcomed this method of examination. However, the OSCE splits overall medical competence into compartments. The ability to manage a patient as a whole is not examined adequately. It also takes a long time to organize. The planning takes several days. However, considering the obvious advantages, the effort is worth it. To clarify certain points, we asked Professor Malhotra whether the OSCE could be used for testing higher levels of communication skills.
Yes, I'll give you an example. You could ask the candidate to pacify the agitated wife of a patient who's developed severe hematuria after a kidney biopsy.
Can we assess skills of therapeutic or diagnostic procedures?
It would be unethical to ask the candidate to do such procedures on an actual patient, but you could use simulators. Simulators are available, though expensive, for almost every skill. For example, endotracheal intubation, defibrillation, arterial puncture, venous puncture, and so on.
As all 20 students, they start simultaneously, some of them would start at stations which are dependent on what they observed in previous one. So how do you sort this out?
Candidates who start from such stations, they are asked to do nothing in the first 5 minutes. Then they join the others in the mainstream. At the end of the whole OSCE, they will be left with their first station, for which they are given 5 minutes extra.
Although the OSCE is a near-perfect method of practical examination and has replaced the complete examination in some countries, some experts feel that the long case is still necessary. They feel that a combination of an OSCE with a long case is a near-ideal situation. An OSCE can also be used as a teaching tool. Used in a formative examination, it can provide an excellent feedback to both students and teachers about the lacunae in the training of skills.